Thank you. cut it out. And he said, cut it out, cut it out, cut it out. And so finally the guy put it down and finally off and broke the deal. The guy said, man, good night, why did you stop? So he told me to stop, what's happening? He said, well, I tried, but it was all the one strand.
Hospital at my day, and they can sit over there for a minimum of 48 hours in the emergency room. Now, that was the county hospital, and I had that beat for a long time. That's all your shootings, all your cuttings, all your killings, all your bad car accidents and stuff. They all got shipped over to that hospital. And those kids had to be there when all that stuff came in there so they get a good idea of what reality is. But nowadays, you get to thinking it's some kind of a game. And you don't realize it, and it's not your fault. You don't realize that what that does is the more stuff like that you see, the more desensitized you become to it, to where you grow so accustomed to it, it's just like eating breakfast. You don't think nothing of it.
Yeah.
What I'm going to do tonight is I'm going to go through a passage here, and I'm going to explain to you before I show it, I'm going to explain to you and ask you maybe to write a few of these things down. And you can dump it when it gets ready to go through the slides here. And I'm going to show you some things that will show you what sin does and the consequences of sin if you don't stop your foolishness. And hopefully, maybe the Lord will use the thing to show you that when the Lord says the wages of sin is death, he means it. But sometimes there's things worse than death. So I hope that as we go through this, and now there's only one stipulation after the little kids are gone out of here, when we start the slides or when I start the thing up here, the only thing that I would ask is if you don't want to see it, close your eyes or turn away, and nobody's going to make fun of you. If they do, I'll have a couple of these big boys take them outside and talk to them.
Amen.
Nobody laughs or mocks or makes fun of somebody. Some of this stuff on the show is pretty bad stuff. It's just car wrecks. It's just bodies. It's just real life things, real scenes, and real incidents. I was there. But not everybody's cut out to see that. And so if you look away from it, it's okay. We won't want to make fun of you. But sin's not something to look at. And I think that I've been kind of had a little bit of a resurgence now. I feel like that kids are not aware of the dangers of it. You hear all the stories and you act like it doesn't really happen to people that I know. Well, these are real people, and these are real people that I know, and I'll show you some of these things, and I hope it'll be a help to you and a blessing to you, but I don't want you making fun of anybody. I don't want you laughing and cutting up clowning around about it, because it's really not funny. Okay? Matthew chapter 27, I want you to stand for just a second. Let me say this, I appreciate being here all day. I've already had a good time. I've enjoyed the fellowship. I've been sitting around the table. And I appreciate you coming and making me feel at home and sit at the table and talk to me. Even if you don't like me, make me feel like you. I like that. I appreciate you coming by and saying hello to TikTok. I appreciate that message. Even if you did, it makes me feel good. Oh man, likes to be told he's still worth something every now and then. But I appreciate it. Y'all been very hospitable, and I really do appreciate it. Matthew chapter 27, this is probably the definitive chapter of the entire Bible on crucifixion. It's a little bit more descriptive than the other chapters, though the other chapters have it in there. Matthew chapter 27, now they've already brought the Lord up there. They've already beaten him, and they put on him the scarlet robe and the crown of thorns, and they've smacked him around, they plucked his beard, and they spat upon him. And now they're getting ready to take him out and crucify him. We'll pick it up in verse number 33. And when they were coming to a place called Golgotha, that is to say, a place of a skull, they gave him vinegar to drink mingled with gall. When he had tasted thereof, he would not drink. And they crucified him and parted his garments, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled as is spoken by the prophet. They parted my garments among them, and upon my vesture did they cast lots. And sitting down, they watched him there. And then come on down, if you will, please, to verse 39. They passed by, reviled him, wagging their heads and saying, Thou that destroyest the temple and buildest it in 3 days, save thyself, if thou be the Son of God, come down from the cross. Brother Steve, you pray that's not the blessing.
Father, we
started
to be before the spirit of the gentleman here over the hearts that is in the Lord works in their hearts.
Amen. Thank you. You can be seated. Those questions are there to ask you the question number 34. If you were to think that there would be a time in Jesus' life where he would have more pressure on him than everything, he's been beaten now, and I realize they can't take his life, he has to lay his life down. I understand that. But he's in a moment of real great stress. If there's ever anybody that's been under stress, it would be Jesus on the cross. Is that a fair statement? And look what shows up right when he's under stress, right when he is distressed to the point of breaking. Jesus Christ, they come up there with the vinegar, which is not like apple cider vinegar or vinegar your mom cooks with or something like that. This is an anesthetic that will try to give him to make the pain go away. And the Bible says when he tasted thereof, when he realized they weren't just giving him water, they were given him something that he shouldn't be drinking that was fermented. He said, I'm not going to do it. Because what sin does is it waits until the moment that you're the most depressed, you're the most discouraged, you're the most downtrodden, and that's when sin shows up and tries to get you to do the wrong thing. Well, one of the things that a lot of people don't pay any attention to, and very few preachers even talk about, is that suicide among teenagers probably ranks right up there close to the top. It was the top spot a couple of years ago, over all the other reasons for suicide. Right now, PTSD and stuff, and people coming back from overseas, is outrunning the teenagers, but we have a very high suicide rate. You say, why do you think that is, preacher? I think a couple of things. I think, first of all, I think that you see television and magazines and stuff on the internet and all that other stuff in this virtual world that's everything you can't be and everything that they call success, and you're not able to obtain that. That's depressing. You're not able to have everything everybody else has. You're not able to do everything everybody else can do. You're not able to look the way everybody else looks, and so you get depressed. I know there was a girl back home that wanted to have some cosmetic surgery. She was only 14 years old, and several of the girls have had some surgery. Their parents are idiots to let her do that, which I think they're idiots. I mean, unless it's surgically necessary because of the deformity, I think you're an idiot to try to do that. You're drawing attention to the wrong thing. That's just my opinion. You can take it or leave it. It's not mine, but I don't think it's wrong. But 14 years old is too young to have that kind of stuff done. Well, she got mad about it. And so her mom and daddy said, well, listen, we're sorry you're getting mad, but we're not going to let you do that. And said, me and your brother, or we're going to go up here to the famous things and get something to eat. And so she said, I don't want to go. She did the typical stalling term. You know, when you get mad at mom and dad, they went up the street to famous Amos. When they got back home, they opened up the door, and that girl had taken her daddy's 12-gauge shotgun and put it right in the center of her chest and leaned over and put her thumb in the trigger valve, the thumbprint right there, and pulled the trigger and blew the heart out of the back of her chest. You say, why did she do that? She was depressed. She couldn't get what she wanted. You say, well, she's a spoiled brat. Maybe, but she's dead now. You see, what happens is the sin will get you to convince that, you know what, you don't get what you want to get, so it's not worth living. You're going to tell me that's worth dying for? But sin gets you in a position, kids, when you get down and depressed, where you start thinking about doing stuff you shouldn't be doing. I can give you story after story after story. I'm going to show you a lady tonight who got to the point that she couldn't take it anymore, and she put a shotgun in her mouth, and she took her head off while her kids were watching. You say, why? Sin makes you lose your mind. Look, if you go a little bit further than that, let me just show you a few of these things here, then we'll let you hit go. And you just notice in verse number 34 there again, or 35 there, sin causes the innocent to die. In other words, it doesn't necessarily mean that the one doing the sin is the one that dies. Sometimes the one that does the sin is the one that's the killer for other people. It winds up being the one that is the executioner of innocent people. Jesus Christ was innocent. They hung him on the cross. The closest thing I've ever seen to that depiction, I never saw the whole thing, but I did see bits and pieces of that thing that Gibson did, and he got that probably pretty close to right. His visit was more than any man. The beating that the Lord took was beyond anything that anybody could imagine. The people nowadays want to hang Jesus on the cross, and they want to kind of make it a pretty thing. It wasn't pretty at all. They beat him, and they beat him, and mutilated him, and did everything but break bones in. And the Bible says his visage was marred more than any man. I'll show you a visage tonight that's marred. And if his visage was worse than that, his own mother wouldn't have recognized him because they beat him so bad. And when the Jesus Christ hangs up there, what happens a lot of times is innocents die. A little baby was got some things going on one time. A little baby was stricken in the yard in the room there. A man came home from prison, and he was mad and upset and angry screaming at his girlfriend and stuff, and then she got him, got in a fight, and he killed his girlfriend, and then the mother-in-law got involved, and he killed her, and that baby kept screaming, and kept screaming, and kept screaming, he went in there and took a big butcher knife, and he jammed that baby down to the floor, and just stuck the baby to the floor, but my SWAT guys pulled in there and got there, and he took his life before he could get him and take him out, coward's way out, and he walked in there, and right as we kicked in the door, he shot himself there, and that baby was down there spinning around on that knife, and of course it already died. See where it slipped around and slid around in that blood. Completely innocent baby. You say, well, what makes somebody do that? Sin. So, preacher, you're making that stuff up. No, I'm not making it up at all. I'm not even telling you the half of it. I'm telling you, you're playing around with something that you're going to realize how deep it can take you and how messed up it can make you. I'm telling you that the stuff it can do to you mentally and the stuff it can do to you emotionally and the stuff it can do to you spiritually. You say, preacher, you talk like a tree fell on me, like you're crazy. You've ever read the story of the devil-possessed man in Gadarene? Do you read your Bible? In Mark chapter
the devil-possessed man of Galilee running around in tombs with dead people.
Yeah.
Nowadays, they make movies out of them and call them zombies and stuff like that. He's running around, he's comfortable in tombs around graveyards. Any of you ever been in a graveyard at nighttime? By yourself? Have me delivered, man. I don't even like to be in a church by myself at nighttime, let alone a graveyard. We used to get these calls out there, they're desecrating graves. And you go out there and it's like, I'm waiting on backup, man. I mean, I've gone into buildings, gone into burglaries, gone into robberies in progress by, you know, by myself, not waiting on backup. Now the graveyard, I'll be at the entrance of the graveyard, I'll wait for my backup here. So why? There's a group of muscles in there, something. I don't know. I don't even care if they're not in there. If I think they're in there, they're in there. Who can't shoot a building monster? I mean, you just go right through it. So it's like, I'll wait on back to hear everybody, you know, clicking on the microphone or making fun of them and stuff like that. Hey, you want to come over here? Radio goes silent. That guy's comfortable in a graveyard. What does that tell you about? He likes to be around dead things. What is he doing? He's running around naked. You know what the Bible says? That people were afraid of him. They said they got him, and several of them got hold of him, and they grabbed him, put him in fetters and chains. He broke them. He beat people. He wore people out. That's in your mind. That's a devil-possessed man. You say, why? When you start messing around with sin, you don't know what you're capable of doing. It's a whole lot worse than just drugs. But when you use drugs to transfer over into that spiritual realm, or you use liquor and alcohol to transfer into that spiritual realm, you become the possession of things that live out there. Listen, they can't take your soul, but they can take your body. You yield your members, they'll be instruments of his to obey. Romans chapter number 6. And the next thing you know, you done tripped off into another lane over there, and something's over there getting a hold of you, and you're capable of doing stuff you never do. I'll show you some of that. You see, well, preacher, it's just hard for me to imagine. What I'm trying to explain to you, it is as bad as you can possibly imagine and then some. Look on down in the passage very quickly. Look at verse number 36. And all but 35 right there, he says this. He says in verse 35, they parted my garments and they cast lots upon them. You know what sin caused you to do? It'll cause you to gamble or take chances. To think you'll get away with it. I won't get caught. It'll never get me. I'll show you some illustrations of that tonight. And sin always causes, verse number 36, it always causes people to watch, sitting down and watching. When you sin, other people will watch. Give me any of you a real great verse for you to think about next time you decide to turn on the TV or next time you turn on the internet to help you to understand what God thinks about what you're doing. Look at Romans chapter number 1. Leave your finger there in Matthew 27. Let me show you something. Sin always causes other people to watch. We had a bad wreck one day. I might use this illustration a little bit here. There's a few people here that have heard it. We worked a bad wreck one day. A guy had a red firework. And he ran that firework in. As far as I'm concerned, he's guilty of killing the guy. sin by yourself. She said, well, I just go to my room and I sin by myself. No, you involve somebody else in it, no matter what. Sometimes it's even electronically.
Yeah.
That's a straightforward point.
Come on, stay there.
You say, oh, what are you doing? I'm telling you. Look at the last verse in the book of Romans. Comes down through there, he knows all the things you're able to draw all this stuff there. You see that? Somebody got that passage there? You know, in Romans chapter number 1, we read about the last three verses to rule out that.
Satisfied with hatred of God, spite of the proud boasters, and bitter of evil things, disobedient parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, inflecting, impeccable, unmerciful, who know the justice of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only to do the same, but to have pleasure in them that do it.
Not only all the ones that did it, but the ones that take pleasure in watching what the other ones that are sinning are doing. Look at it. You don't take pleasure in watching the Hollywood thing, the Kardashians, the housewives, all that kind of thing. So what are you doing? You're taking pleasure in somebody else's sin. Well, then you're guilty of it.
Yeah, amen.
You say, how do you think that stuff stays on TV? Because you want to. The ratings come in and they say, that's good advertising right there. We know a bunch of stupid people that watch the tragedy and the trash in everybody else's life. So we'll just run all that junk out here and let you see all the foolishness that they get involved in. And the advertisers will come in and say, I'll have a little bit of that. And they advertise on there because they know you're watching it. Your Bible tells you, come back to Matthew 27, measure guilty of that thing because you're taking pleasure in that stuff. Well, you know what happens? Sin always calls. Let's give you, I've seen it happen a few times. It never fails. The always girls usually run in pairs, either two or three on a regular basis. But if one of a sudden God starts dealing with one of the girls, that other girl or those other two girls will get that girl and do their best to get her away because she's getting ready to make a decision. She's going to mess up their plans. I've seen that happen with guys. I like this setup right here. When we do our youth camp, we break them up into teams. They have to sit the teams. So if there happens to be a little boyfriend, romance, something else going on, we split them up. You say, well, you should do that. They're going to get together anyway. Well, not while I'm around them. You say, what do you do? We chaperone them. Yeah. When we have kids come to our camp, they come to camp knowing you're coming for preaching. You're not coming for playing. You're going to get four sermons a day when we go to our camp. They get four sermons a day. Can you imagine that? Four sermons a day. That doesn't include devotion time. One of the other guys preaches and then I'll preach, and then in the afternoon, one of the other guys preaches and then I'll preach. That's four sermons a day. By the time they're done, at the end of 5 days of camp, they've had 5 weeks worth of preaching. And they know that's what they're coming for. We're different. At our camp, we don't say anybody who can come wants to come. You know what we say? We say, if you want to come, you're welcome to come. But if you want to come and bring your CDs and bring your iPad or iPod or mini pod and all that other kind of stuff, you want to bring your telephone, you're going to be worried about that stuff, stay at home. We don't want you going. We're going to get along with the Lord. You say you shouldn't be that way. Well, we're not going to spend all the time worrying about the yahoos that don't want to get in line. We're there to minister to the people that want to get in. I care to preach to those of you that want to get in. There'll be a few of you that'll be brats this week. There'll be a few of you that'll be honoring this week. There'll be a few of you that when God starts dealing with your friend, you'll be the one trying to pull them off the side. I'm bored. I don't like this. I don't want to be around here. I don't like being here. I don't like the food. I don't like this. I don't like that. Okay, well, we're not here for you.
That's right.
You're a cotton-picking, entitled, spoiled brat, what you are.
Yeah.
The whole world revolves around you. You think, hey, I'm the center of attention here. Well, not here. Jesus Christ did it.
Yeah.
But I've never seen that not happen. I've never seen it. Whenever somebody has, they can't do it by themselves. Don't tell me you want to be a single individual. Don't tell me that you want to go out here and be your own person. Don't tell me that you know you don't care what anybody else thinks. If you did, you'd walk off without leaving a wake of dead bodies in your past. If they don't go along with you, you know what you do? You've got to do whatever you can to try to hook them up. They get right with God. It's like, well, man, don't mess my plans up. I've seen guys that get sweet on some girl or something like that. Think they're going to get some sugar after the meeting's over with or something like that. And God starts trying to deal with the girl. The girl don't want to give them the time of day. They got to start running the preacher down and trying to cause a problem and get her out back behind the building somewhere or off somewhere in the gospel or whatever to try to get an opportunity to get her mind off of what God's dealing with her about. See, how do you know that stuff? I've been around a long time. I've been in a lot of youth camps. I was a kid once, back in the 90s. That's how they started that whole thing. And they knew once they got you talking about yourself, and once they got you talking about other people, they knew the thing would take off and run like crazy. And that's where the original idea came from. And you know what they, proven? They were exactly right. Because all that is talk about me, talk about me, talk about me. A lady told me one time, she says, I only use it for my family. I said, really? You just use it for your family? She said, yes, just fine. I said, you don't have anybody else on there? Well, maybe, but you. And I said, you share all like your baby pictures and all that other kind of stuff with them? Well, no. I said, man, if you knew what I know about pedophiles and stuff like that, and having to be in the tech division for a number of years and pull with all that stuff, I said, you wouldn't put nothing on your little kids on that stuff if you knew what they did with their pictures. I made you mad yet? Good, it's good for you. You say, well, you have no concept of what they're doing out there in the virtual world. You feel like giving yet? That's what sin does. It's filthy. It's nasty. It's dirty. You say, well, I know some good people that fool around that stuff. Okay, fine. I don't care about what's my stuff. That's the wrong fault. What are you doing with it? If your justification is somebody else is doing it, then you all might be doing it. If it's right for you, good. How about it? Smoke what you got. God, can you bless it? And whatsoever you do, in word or deed, do all the glory of God. Can you ask God to bless what you're fixing to send out over that post thing or whatever you do? Well, if you can, have at it. You can pop the top on them and suds and pour it back. God bless this beer in the name of Jesus Christ. Have at it. I'm for it. But you can't do that with your conscience. Mighty quiet tonight. You say, what are you talking about, preacher? I'm talking about sin. I'm talking about when you send other people to watch what you're doing. Sin will make you mock, belittle, make fun of God. They go by there and they're laughing at God. They're always telling them, come down, come down, come down. You get right at camp this week, you know what's going to happen as soon as you get back home? You ain't going to be home 2 hours. You're going to reconnect to the web and reconnect to all the people out there and get back in touch with all the people that you've been missing for years, that you've been in isolation. It's been so terrible. I've been disconnected for so long. You're going to get reconnected to what you're going to do. Sin causes darkness. That's one of the things that's there. It blinds you. You start doing things you sin, you don't even realize the stuff you're doing. You get accustomed to the filth. Anybody ever seen that thing they got to deal with about hoarders? You know what a hoarder is? How many of you know what a hoarder is? Okay, good. You know, it's somebody that likes to keep trash around all the time. You're not me a Christian. I'm a preacher. I get sermon illustrations all along. He said, well, hold on to a bunch of trash that nobody ought to have to mean something to you. With somebody else or some kind of bitterness or something like that, and they just hold on to it until they drown in it. I'm going to get down here in Christians. But you know what they do? They get accustomed to that filth. Anybody here know anything about chains? You ever played chains? You got 20 on? You know what chains do? They do. They were dumb. They were dumb. Come on, tell the truth, right? Anything they get their feet into. Now, isn't that a strange thing? That's like some of you. You're continuing to eat stuff you should have let go a long time ago. You keep going back to it, keep going back to it, keep going back to it, keep going back to it. Or you have people around you keep reminding you of your past, reminding you of your past, reminding you of your past, and you keep going around. That's why you can't get 1, 2, 3 feet off the ground. You're eating stuff you should have done. That's not too plain for you, is it? Not as plain as that garbage you watch on your box every day sitting coming through your living room. Is what happened to sin. You get used to it. I can tell some of you right now, you're used to it. You can turn on that stuff and listen to that. I don't know if you've listened to that stuff lately. I haven't been exposed to it for a long time. They turn on that, some of that music and stuff, and the filthiest stuff, talking about the boys and girls, and talking about stuff going on, and talking about murder and killing and all kind of things like that. And kids singing the song, you get accustomed to it. It's like, what's the big deal? It's just a song. It's just talking about so-and-so getting raped, and so-and-so getting robbed, and so-and-so going down, and so-and-so this, and so-and-so. You get to play in these games, auto theft game. They get a big investigation on that, auto theft game. You get points for running over the bag lane, you're running over the lady in the grocery cart. You get points for shooting the police when they're trying to stop you. You get points for running over a pedestrian
What kind of stuff is that? You got to be freedom. That makes you jaded. You get hardened to it. You get used to it. You get accustomed to it. And then when the light comes on, it's so dark it can't penetrate in there. Your heart gets hard. You get cold. And you just sit there like a fish that's just been pulled out of the water. You're
saddest thing.
I remember